Good morning. I'm Dr. R.M. Ilarasi, Associate Professor and Head, PG and Research Department of Chemistry. Today, I'm going to deal with a very simple topic called phase rule. This is coming under the unit phase equilibria, which is a chapter in 5th semester of 3rd BSc Chemistry. Phase rule is an important tool used in the quantitative treatment of systems in equilibrium. We know about equilibrium, right? And this also explains about the conditions which must be specified in order that a system can exist in equilibrium. A scientist by name Willard Gibbs in the year 1876 was working on heterogeneous equilibria, and he arrived at a famous mathematical expression called phase rule, which is given by F is equal to C minus P plus 2. Let us see what do each of these terms represent. F represents the number of degrees of freedom. C represents the number of components, and P represents the number of phases. So let me tell you about these terms individually. A phase. What is meant by a phase? A phase is a homogeneous and physically distinct part of a system. Homogeneous means single. Homogeneous and physically distinct part of a system which can be separate that from the other parts of the system by mechanical boundaries. Let me give you a few examples, you will understand it much better. Suppose if we take a mixture of gases, for example, let me mix hydrogen gas and oxygen gas in a container. Gases are completely miscible with each other, so they will be having only one phase. Now I'll take into account liquids. Consider any two liquids. For example, let me take water and alcohol. When I mean alcohol, I mean ethyl alcohol. Water and alcohol are completely miscible with each other. So if you take, say for example, 50 ml of water and 50 ml of alcohol, mix them with each other, you will be getting a single solution, homogeneous solution. You will not be able to distinguish between water and alcohol. But so these two are called as completely miscible liquids. At the same time, if you take water and an organic solvents like chloroform, they are completely immiscible with each other. They do not mix with each other. So when you take into account these two liquids in a single container, you will be finding two different layers. So the number of phases over here is 2. I'll take one more example. Decomposition of calcium carbonate. Remember, we are talking about systems in equilibrium. So calcium carbonate is a solid. It decomposes to give calcium oxide, another solid, and carbon dioxide, a gas. So the number of phases in this particular equilibrium reaction is 3. Because this is a different solid, this is a different solid, and the third phase is gas. So now we know what is a phase. Phase is a homogeneous and physically distinct part of a system. Then let us consider what is meant by a component. Component is defined as the number of distinct species which are needed to explain about each and every phase. I will explain with an example. Consider water. Do you know how many phases water can exist? It can exist in the solid phase, it can exist in the liquid phase, and it can exist in the vapor phase also. In the solid state, you call that as ice. Ice is in equilibrium with water, liquid, which is in equilibrium with vapor. Okay, now it contains three different phases, right? You have a solid phase, you have a liquid phase, you have a vapor phase. But each of these phases can be expressed by a single formula called H2O. So H2O represents solid water, liquid water and water vapor. So it is an one component system. Another example of a one component system is sulfur. Sulfur can also exist in the form of monoclinic sulfur, rhombic sulfur, liquid sulfur and sulfur vapor. On heating, it changes from monoclinic to rhombic and to liquid and to vapor. Sulfur is a solid, basically yellow color solid. So it is again a one component system. Consider salt solution. You take the common salt which we use at home, dissolve it in water. You will be getting a single phase only, but then you need to explain the components present in that solution. So you have to specify how much of salt is present in that particular solvent. So it is a two component system. Then comes degree of freedom. So degree of freedom is nothing but the number of variables which are needed to specify or explain about a system completely. The variables like pressure, temperature and composition. To explain about any system, we need to describe in terms of pressure, temperature, composition, or otherwise you can call it as concentration also. I'll take an example. A pure gas. You can consider any pure gas, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, anything. So how to explain a pure gas? How many degrees of freedom are needed for a pure gas? You can specify the pressure and temperature or temperature and volume. Initially I said three variables, pressure, temperature and concentration. But if you specify any of these two, the third is automatically specified. So it is a bivariant system. F is equal to 2. Okay. Another example I can give you. Water, liquid, water, vapor. So liquid water is in equilibrium with water vapor. How many degrees of freedom are present in this particular system? So when they are in equilibrium, it specifies that at a particular temperature, the pressure will be having a fixed value. We call that as equilibrium vapor pressure of water. If you specify temperature, pressure is automatically known. If you specify pressure, temperature is automatically known. So in this particular case, the degree of freedom is 1. It is monovariant. The same way you can give other examples which can give the bivariant, trivariant, etc., etc. Okay. Now I said the systems are in equilibrium. What are the different types of equilibrium to be available? One is the systems ought to be in mechanical equilibrium. The systems must be having thermal equilibrium and the systems must be having chemical equilibrium. So when we say the system is having mechanical equilibrium, we say the pressure is constant in all the phases. Thermal equilibrium, temperature is constant. Chemical equilibrium, the chemical potential nu is constant. Okay. So let me discuss about one simple system, the phase diagram of a two component system. Now you are thorough with the equation F is equal to C minus P plus 2. F is number of degrees of freedom, C the number of components, P the number of faces. If the component is 2, then the equation becomes 4 minus P. If the number of faces, minimum number of faces P is 1, F is equal to 3. That means what? We need 3 variables to explain about this particular system completely. Generally, how we do is, we make use of a two-dimensional graph. In a two-dimensional graph, we cannot have 3 variables. So, this equation is modified as F prime is equal to C minus P plus 1. Instead of 2, we are having 1. Why 1? Because we consider the reaction or the system is at a constant pressure, atmospheric pressure. So, this is called as a reduced phase rule equation. Okay. So, I'll take an hypothetical example and explain about the phase diagram of a two-component system. So, I am taking a system of two solids, components A and B. They are not miscible with each other in the solid state. When you melt them together, they become completely miscible. So, there exists a solid-liquid equilibrium. So, in this phase diagram, the point A represents the freezing point of the pure component A. Either you can say freezing point or melting point. And here B represents the freezing point of the pure component B. And as you can see from this phase diagram, I have plotted temperature against composition. Pressure is remaining constant. Okay. Now let us consider this point A. At point A, pure component A is present. You add very small quantity of B to A, what will happen? The freezing temperature will decrease. Keep on adding B, the temperature keeps on decreasing along the curve AC. And this curve AC is called as freezing point curve of component A. And similarly, this point B represents the freezing point of pure component B. You keep on adding small quantities of A, the freezing point keeps on decreasing and ultimately it reaches the point C. Or we can say that the curves AC and BC intersect at the point C. Now let us consider what is happening along this curve AC. I told you this AC has solid A plus solution of B in A. I hope you understand. Initially, we had taken pure component A. You add smaller quantities of B, you get solid A and solution of B in A. Similarly, along this curve BC, we have solid B in equilibrium with the solution of A in B. So, I can write solid B plus solution of A in B. And above this curve ACB, this area represents liquid melt. They are completely miscible with each other. And at the point C, we have solid A, solid B, and the solution of A and B. Three phases are in equilibrium. So now let us see what will be the degree of freedom at along these two curves ACBC at the point C. Now AC, I told you solid A plus liquid solution is present. Two phases are there. So what is the degree of freedom? The equation which we do here is F is equal to C minus P plus 1. C is equal to two component system, number of phases is 2. So ultimately the degree of freedom along the curve AC is 1. It is called as a monovariant or univariant system. The same thing is happening along with the curve BC. The degree of freedom is 1. That means what? You can specify any one of the variable. At this particular point, if you specify temperature, automatically the composition is specified. If you specify a particular composition, automatically the temperature is specified. So it is a univariant system along the curves. In the liquid melt, completely visible, there is only one phase. So what is the degree of freedom over here? Here again, F is equal to 2 minus 1 plus 1, it is 2, bivariant. So if you want to explain about any one particular point along this area, you have to give both the temperature and composition. Then only you can define that particular point. Let us see what is happening at this point C. So what are the things present over there? We have solid A, we have solid B, and the solution. Three different phases are there. So when you do the degree of freedom calculation, 2 minus 3 plus 1, this is equal to 0. So degree of freedom at this point C is 0. It is invariant or non-variant. That means when you say that all the three are coexisting at equilibrium, you need not specify anything. It is understood. This will happen only at a particular temperature and only at a particular composition. And this point is called as eutectic point. Eutectic means easy melting. So below this, you will not be finding any solution at all. Only solid A, solid B, and eutectic mixture. Why this is useful? This simple eutectic system is useful in the isolation of pure metals. One example is lead silver system. So when you get lead, it is mixed with some amount of silver. You need to remove silver. So you can make use of this simple eutectic system to remove silver. So you call the desilverization, and the process is called as Pattinson's process. Other example you can have bismuth, cadmium, then Ki water, etc. All these are two component systems. Okay.